Hi, everybody. Pastor Cliff Mansley here in Surprise, Arizona, coming to you live, sort of, from Grace Community Church. So glad that you could join us for our next exciting study in the Gospel of John. We're at chapter 11, and starting in verse 45, going through 57, we're right at the end. We've just finished up the whole story of Lazarus, which is amazing, because this is the kind of the last major sign that Jesus performs before he resurrects himself. But he resurrects Lazarus from the dead. He's been in the grave 4 days. This is amazing, and it causes quite a stir amongst the Jewish leaders. Let's go ahead and pray before we read this section and then go through it piece by piece. Heavenly Father, thank you that we can study your word, that you don't leave us without anything. You don't leave us guessing. But Lord, you reveal yourself in so many different ways through the scripture. And we just thank you for this privilege to come to your word. So speak to us, we pray, that the Holy Spirit would illumine our hearts and our minds, and that we would adhere in our thinking the very things that are significant to you. Lord, we love you. We thank you for this time. In Jesus' name, amen. All right, friends, so here we are. We're going to go ahead and read this. And again, I'm using the ESV, English Standard Version, as opposed to the NIV. I often like to use the NIV. I think the ESV is a cut above when it comes to translation, but sometimes the NIV is a little simpler to understand. So let's go ahead and, before I get too far down the road into the details of translations and why one is superior to the other, let's go ahead and start reading. Many of the Jews, therefore, verse 45, who had come with Mary and had been and had seen what he did, believed in him. But some of them went to the Pharisees and told them what Jesus had done. So the chief priests and Pharisees gathered the council and said, "What are we to do? For this man performs many signs. If we let him go on like this, everyone will believe in him, and the Romans will come and take away both our place and our nation." But one of them, Caiaphas, who was the high priest that year, said to them, "You know nothing at all, nor do you understand that it is better for you that one man should die for the people, not that the whole nation should perish." He did not say this of his own accord, but being high priest that year, he prophesied that Jesus would die for the nation, and not for the nation only, but also to gather into one the children of God who are scattered abroad. So from that day on, they made plans to put him to death. Jesus therefore no longer walked openly among the Jews, but went from there to the region near the wilderness, to the town called Ephraim, and there he stayed with the disciples. Now the Passover of the Jews was at hand, and many went up from the country to Jerusalem before the Passover to purify themselves. They were looking for Jesus and saying to one another as they stood in the temple, "What do you think? That he will come to the feast at all?" Now the chief priests and the Pharisees had given orders that if anyone knew where he was, he should let them know, so that they might arrest him. Ooh, so that they might arrest him. Oh boy, the chief priests, scribes, Pharisees, they were really on to Jesus at this point in time. They had had their fill. They'd had enough. And the fact that Jesus had done this, performed this miracle just before Passover, as people were pouring into Jerusalem, why, the buzz of this whole thing, this Lazarus resurrection, would be all over the place. Jesus not only walked on water and fed 5,000, gave sight to the blind, and healed the lame so they could walk. I mean, he did all these things, and now this was too much. And so this is a passage where I would say the priests are really freaked out at this point in time. They are really freaked out. And they are very determined that they're going to get Jesus. So let's go ahead and go through this verse by verse. Many of the Jews, now, it's interesting, that little phrase, many of the Jews, it's actually a positive phrase. Why? Because it says many of the Jews, therefore, you know, as a result of what had happened with Lazarus, many of the Jews, therefore, who had come with Mary and had seen what he did, what Jesus did, believed in him. That's astonishing. Many of the people who were there believed in him. But, verse 46, some of them went to the Pharisees and told them what Jesus had done. These guys were tattletales. It was a snitch, 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 snitch. You know, what had Jesus done that was wrong? He raised a dead guy to life, and there's something horrible about that? Oh. Now, I don't know whether they tattled with evil intent or if they told them just because they were astonished themselves. I don't know. But it does seem that they had evil intent in mind. It's just, that's my opinion. For this man performs many, whoops, I jumped ahead. Verse 47. So the chief priests and Pharisees gathered the council. In Greek it says Sanhedrin or Sanhedrin. They gathered the council and said, what are we to do? For this man performs many signs. They were genuinely upset. They didn't know what to do with this guy because Jesus was doing all this stuff. The people were believing. They were following him in droves. It's estimated that a third of the people in Judea and the surrounding area were following Jesus at this point in time. That's how many people were believing in his miraculous signs. So remember, John always calls the miracles signs because they do what? They point to Jesus as the fulfillment of prophecy. So they're perplexed. They don't know what to do. Verse 48 says, if we let him go on like this, everyone will believe in him, and the Romans will come and take away both our place and our nation. Now, what are they talking about here? You need to understand that after Rome, first 400 years before Christ, essentially, the Greeks had come in, conquered Israel, that part of the world, and then the Romans came in and conquered Israel, and the Jews had kind of worked out this cozy situation with the Romans where the Jewish leadership, look, we'll scratch your back if you'll scratch ours. And so the Romans kind of let Caiaphas and let others rule. Well, you had obviously Herod was the king, but he was really just a pawn in essence to the Roman government. And the Jewish leadership knew that they were hanging by a thread in their leadership. And if Jesus came along and claimed to be the Messiah and the people all hailed him as the Messiah, what were the Romans going to do? They were going to come along and they were going to suppress anything, any kind of an uprising, any kind of a person who would claim to be a subversive king, they'd put him down. Well, that would also mean, most likely, that the Jews would lose their place, the Jewish leadership, that is, would lose their place. Remember, Jews was mostly a negative term, but at the beginning of this chapter, it's a positive term. We're going back to the negative terminology. Most of the time when they say Jews in the Bible, it's a negative thing. So the Jewish leadership would lose their power. And most likely, I'm guessing, when they say our place, they're referring to the temple. And they didn't want to lose that power. Ironically, they still lost their power in 70 AD when the Romans conquered Jerusalem and invaded the temple. It still happened. But let's read on, because this gets very interesting. Listen to this. 49, but one of them, Caiaphas, who was the high priest that year. Now, there are some who believe that Caiaphas had actually reigned 18 years, but there usually is a familial group that would have come under Annas, and Caiaphas was his son-in-law. There was kind of this familial group that held power, the high priestly power, and they would rotate that office. I don't know which is which, whether he reigned a solid 18 years as high priest, or if he rotated. But you see, you need to also understand that those priests who filled the role of high priest would also have that honorary title, whether they were in or not. So, but there was a small group of them that would typically share that office. Anyway, he was the high priest that year. Caiaphas probably worked very closely with Pilate in trying to work through the different contentious situations that would arise with the Romans ruling the Jewish population. And so he was kind of a go-between. And Caiaphas, you need to understand it, in this context, as even Josephus says later on, that there was a certain arrogance in this council, the Sanhedrin. And Caiaphas comes along with a little bit of swag, and he says, look, you know nothing at all, nor do you understand that it's better for one man, let me read that again. Nor do you understand that it is better for you that one man should die for the people, not the whole nation perish. What a prophecy! Can you believe this? Here's this guy. He's not a believer in Jesus, and yet he's being prompted to make a very important, very significant prophecy. Now, he's probably thinking in terms of the Romans coming and conquering their nation. But as John often does, he usually has a multi-layered meaning to what he's saying, double meanings that you'll find. And so on the one hand, Caiaphas means this, but on the other hand, John is intending to have Caiaphas point to Jesus as the one who truly does die for the nation. He's pointing to the cross. And this is also probably reminiscent language of the Maccabean revolt back in 67 to what is it, 60 AD, when they had problems with Jerusalem, the temple, and people coming in, Romans coming in and invading. But there's a multi-layer intent here by John. Ultimately, the most important, the most significant, is to point to the cross of Jesus Christ. So, verse 51, he did not say this of his own accord, but being high priest that year, he prophesied that Jesus would die for the nation. There it is. It's pretty explicit. And then 52, and not for the nation only, but also to gather into one the children of God who were scattered abroad. What does that mean? The children of God who are scattered abroad. To the Jews, it would have meant, well, the diaspora, the Jewish people who were scattered amongst the Gentile nations. But I think if you go back in the Bible to just back to chapter 10, verse 16, we get a little more of an understanding. Jesus says, well, he says back in verse 14, I'm the good shepherd. I know my own and my own know me. just as the Father knows me, and I know the Father, and I lay down my life for the sheep, and I have other sheep that are not of this fold. In other words, other sheep that are not Jewish. And that's mind-blowing to the Jewish culture at the time. I must bring them also, and they will listen to my voice, so there will be one flock, one shepherd. Oh, this is great stuff. So we're reading here in John about how there were to be both Jews and Gentiles in the family of God. This is powerful stuff. And so, verse 53, so from that day on, they made plans to put him to death. This was it. The words of Jesus, the actions of Jesus, the signs of Jesus were too much for them. They'd had enough. And Caiaphas said, he must die. He must die so that the nation doesn't perish, so that they don't lose their semi-autonomous position with Rome, so that it's not a complete iron fist coming down upon them. You can understand, this would be a genuine concern on their parts. You don't want to completely say that they were being disingenuous. They weren't. They truly believed that their being able to hold on to a certain level of power allowed them a certain level of freedom under the rule and reign of the Roman Empire. So where are we here? Verse 54. Jesus, therefore, no longer walked openly among the Jews. Okay, therefore, because he was under a death threat now, and that word probably got out and about pretty quickly, he no longer walked openly among the Jews, but went from there to the region near the wilderness to a town called Ephraim, which is about 12 miles north of Jerusalem. And there he stayed with his disciples. In fact, what Jesus is doing is he's going underground. He has determined, how do we say that? We throughout the Gospel of John, Jesus says, my hour has not yet come. My hour has not yet come. My hour has not yet come. So Jesus is not going to let Caiaphas or anyone else take his life at the wrong time. Jesus knows exactly the time and the place, and so he is keeping in step with that by avoiding those who would take his life. And so he goes up to the wilderness, near the wilderness to Ephraim, and at this point we don't see much of Jesus outside of his smaller group of disciples. Really, there's only one more public appearance that Jesus makes after this, before his crucifixion, and that was when Palm Sunday came around and he made his triumphal entry into Jerusalem. And at that point, he was pleading with people for them to believe. And he goes into the only time he comes out of hiding, so to speak, is to go into Jerusalem or in the triumphal entry on Palm Sunday, and now verse 55, now the Passover of the Jews was at hand, and many went up from the country to Jerusalem before the Passover to purify themselves. Remember, there were three festivals that you had to attend in Jerusalem if you were a Jewish male of age. You had to be there three times. So there were a lot of people that would go in. Now, that didn't mean that there weren't women and children who would go along. That was often the case too. Whole towns would go and walk together to Jerusalem. people were looking for them. The Jewish leadership was looking intently for Jesus. Verse 56, they were looking for Jesus and saying to one another as they stood in the temple, well, what do you think? What do you think? That he will not come to the feast at all? So they were really, they couldn't find him. They didn't know what was going on. And now the chief priests, verse 57, and Pharisees had given orders that if anyone knew where he was, he should let them know so that they might arrest him. So they were actively soliciting the assistance of people in the crowd to help them to take Jesus and to arrest him and then ultimately put him to death. Well, there's a lot going on here. We're only at chapter 11. There's still a lot to happen. We're almost to the very bottom of, if you'll remember, at the very beginning of our study, we spoke about the Gospel of John being like a pendulum, shaped like a pendulum. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and he was with God in the beginning. And at that point, he's descending from heaven and going through trials. All of the Gospel of John is trial language. So God, in essence, in Christ, is on trial throughout the Gospel. And it goes down to the darkest place, which is chapter 13. And we're quickly coming up on that after we hit chapter 12. We get to the betrayal of Judas, and then we go up, the last week of Jesus' life, Holy Week, which is the second half of the Gospel of John. And that is, remember, that's called, the first half is called the Book of Signs, where he's performing all these signs, pointing to him as the Messiah. The second half of the Gospel is known of the Book of Glory, which points to Christ's glorification on the cross. And I can't wait to get into all that with you. But, friends, I just hope and pray that you're like those Jews that were with Mary and saw what Jesus did and believed. I can tell you in my own life, I've seen so many things that Jesus has done, so many things where he's confirmed his existence, not only his existence, his lordship, the fact that he's with me, the fact that I have a new life in Christ, I've been born again. So significant. I just had a gentleman in my office yesterday who is born again. He saw the life, the person, the works of Jesus Christ, and he had to give his heart to him. What a beautiful thing. I hope that you have given your heart to Jesus. I don't know how people live without him. Remember the old Keith Green song? Maybe some of you remember. How can they live without Jesus? How can they live without God's love? We live in a world that's become so dark and so evil that I look at it and I just, Lord, we're turning away from you more and more. How can people live without you? How can people live without meaning or purpose? Help us not to crucify you in our hearts, but to crucify our sinful nature and to live for you, O Lord, for you are good. Heavenly Father, I pray that your hand of blessing would be upon every person who's tuned into this lesson. And Lord, that the things that we spoke about today would sink deeply into their hearts. We love you, Lord Jesus, and we dedicate our lives to you again now. For we pray this all in Jesus' precious name. Amen. Well, friends, until we meet again, keep your eyes fixed on Jesus.